My name is Manleen Sandhu. Today's date is 19th May 2013. I'm interviewing Dr. Jaswant Singh Neki for the first time. The interview is taking place in New Delhi and is being conducted on behalf of the 1947 Partition Archive and Guru Nanak Dev University. Could you please tell us your name?
Well, my name is Jaswant Neki. And before partition, we lived in Quetta, Balochistan. And I was studying at that time in Lahore in medical college. That was my final year in that college at that time. I was in the hostel right up to the partition day. And I didn't know where my parents had gone because Quetta had already been ransacked. And I didn't know where they are. And I did not know anyone towards the east of Lahore. So I didn't know where to go. So I was standing. And the one man, one Sikh only, and the one non-Muslim only in the hostel. And somebody came and told me, "Doc, please leave the town. You are unsafe." I didn't know where to go. So I kept praying and did nothing else. Towards the evening, late evening, my door tapped and I shivered, thinking my time has come. But it hadn't. There was another Sikh class fellow of mine who was living in the town somewhere else, and his parents had gone to Amritsar on a wedding but had not returned, and he didn't know what to do. So I asked him in and told him, we'll plan something, come in. So I asked him, "How did you come?" He said, "In my father's car." So I said, "All right, then we have some transport available." So we thought we'll stay together at night and leave early morning before others wake up. But the car didn't have petrol for the travel that we had to undertake. So we went to a petrol station, and the owner of that said, "Oh, Sikhs, you are still here?" But he gave us petrol. And he also guided us how to leave the town through smaller streets and not through main roads. And so we were out of the town safely before sunrise. And we thought we'll be in Amritsar pretty soon. We had barely gone about 10 miles when our car started hiccuping. And then stopped. The starter won't start it, and we didn't know what to do about it. And I at that time noticed that there was a village nearby where people had collected around their village well, and they were armed, and they had seen us. So pretty soon they started walking towards us. In those days, there was sometimes a car was started with a handle. So I took out the handle, put in, but it won't turn. I made all my effort. All that happened was that I could lift the car, and as it fell down, it started. So I got into the car immediately. But immediately as we moved, that crowd had come and it broke our hind sheet, glass. But anyway, we had escaped death. We could reach Amritsar. Now he had his relatives, so he would go there. I didn't have anyone in Amritsar whom I knew. So I went to Darbar Sahib. As I arrived there, one of my classmates at Lahore, who had come to Amritsar, met me and said, "Where have you been?" I said, I was still in Lahore till yesterday when the Pakistan flag came up. He said, "Then now, what are you doing now?" I said, "I've just arrived. I don't know what to do." So I said, "Why not go to the college here? I might have still room for you." So I went to the college. And there was only one seat in a room where four could live. So that there was no other choice for me. So I accepted that. Said it got me a roof. But the three others, no one wanted to live with them because they were all drunkards. So I used to stay there. One would drink and start calling names. The second would just pass out. And the third one would start bragging and abusing. So for full 1 year, I had to serve them. Anyway, I got the roof over me. Then there was a servant who was serving me in Lahore. He came to me. And he said, "I've started a kitchen here. And I would request you to eat at my kitchen." I said, "I have no money." He said, "Don't worry. You eat your food. Pay me whenever you can." So the two things were over. And the college postponed asking me for their fees, tuition fees, till we had to go to the university for the examination. Then they asked for fees and the university examination fee. That about turned out to be about over 1,000. And I had no penny. So in the great dismay, I moved out of the town, just loitering away. And then someone from behind called, "Jaswant." And I stopped and looked at him. An old man on a bicycle was coming. So he came and said, "You don't know me, but I know you." I said, "Thank you." He said, "I have some problem. I'm carrying some money and don't want to carry it to the place where I'm going. Want to leave it with you." I said, "Please, no, don't. Because I'm in great need and I'll just spend it." He said, "The money is only to spend. Spend it." I said, "But how will I give you?" He said, "I'll come to you again and take it from you when you have it." So he gave me 2,000 rupees. And I could pay off the fees of the college as well as the university. I passed out and went to the hospital as a house physician. As a junior house physician, we got nothing. As a senior, we could use to get about 150 per month. And as junior house physicians, we protested, why should we not get money? Because we are doing the same work as the seniors do. So for 6 months that we were there, nobody decided about it. When I was senior house physician for 2 or 3 months, then it was decided that you will also get so much per month and the seniors will get so much more per month. And then I got something like 2,020 rupees. And I thought this was my time to make a feast somewhere. As I stepped out of the hospital, the old man was standing there and said, "Now you have money, give me my 2,000. So I gave him his 2,000. That was what happened with me within the first year that I was there. I had no clothes. There were only two pairs of change. I used to wear them and wash them and wear them and wash them. That continued for the whole year, till my pant worn out from behind. And I didn't know what to do about it. So I tried to mend it, but I didn't have the thread. I could get white thread with which I would stitch my pajama and so on. So with a pencil, heliotropic pencil, I colored it. And after coloring it, I tried to mend it. And that mend would show. But with that, I continued for several months. So that is how I passed my first year after partition. During that period, two things happened. One, that there was a student body that had come up, All India Sikh Student Federation. And they invited me to join it, and I joined it. I had joined it about a year ago. And that year, just before partition, they had elected me as their vice president. And when I was fighting that election, can you guess who was collecting votes for me? Dr. Manmohan Singh, our Prime Minister. He told me that, I didn't know it.
And this is in Lahore, for partition.
Lahore. Manmohan was not in Lahore then. Since it was an All India organization, he was in the Northwest Frontier Province, and he collected my votes that were there for me. Now, at that time, immediately after partition, in Lahore there was a DAV college where they had established a refugee camp, and cholera broke out there, so they had to close that, and an alternative camp was required. And I was called by Gyani Kartar Singh. He was an Akali leader there and was sympathizer of the Sikh Student Federation. And he asked me to go and establish an alternative refugee camp in Sikh National College in Lahore. So I gathered some of my colleagues and some other volunteers. We were about 15 of us. We went and established a parallel refugee camp there. And one night, we received 15 injured and 2 dead. They were coming in a train and were attacked. We had to look after them. And soon the strength of the refugees at the camp went beyond 10,000. And we had only one well from which we could draw water. There was no other water supply. So So we didn't want everyone to come and put his bucket in and draw out. We made a camp and an arrangement for a contrivance which would bring out the water from the river, and we would collect it in a tub, and everyone could take it from the tub so that we don't pollute the way. Now, that continued for some time. Then what happened, a very strange thing happened. We had been given a Gurkha platoon to guard us. And the chief was a European, a Britisher. And one of our Gurkha soldiers had gone out to make some purchases for the people there. And someone came on a bicycle and pushed his hand into his rifle's support and took away his rifle. Now that irritated the Gurkhas. So three of them went out and brought the rifles in the same way from five policemen of Pakistan. Now that created a kalahu there. So a systematic inquiry was made into our camp. By that time, that those five rifles, the Gurkhas had quite a distance from our camp, buried. So they came and inspected the camp left and right and couldn't find that. But they found the talwars that our people who we had kept in had deposited in our office. And so they took them away, so that we are totally unarmed. Anyway, that happened. Then 3 days later, we were told that the governor of Punjab and commander-in-chief of the Pakistani forces and deputy commissioner of Lahore are going to visit our camp. So suddenly an idea came into my mind that if we can please them, we could get some concessions from them for our refugees. So we took out all the blackboards that were in our classrooms and put them on the roadside and wrote out the concessions that you are receiving here, and concessions and courtesies that you are receiving here are the kindness of the Pakistan government, and we are indebted to them. When you go back, tell them all this so that the refugees coming from there to Pakistan get similar treatment. Now that pleased them. And the governor asked me, anything we can do for you? So I said, one, get our well disinfected. Number two, there is a lot of mosquitoes here and we get malaria patients. Get the whole area strewn with the anti-malarial spray. And third, you give us anti-cholera vaccine so that we don't get cholera like the other camp. And all three things came in. Now, something happened 10 days later. A man from the town comes and tells the guard on our gate outside that There is a family, an old man, his two daughters, Hindu family. And they are living in named the colony. They are living in that colony. And the police have eyes on them. They think they will kill the old man and kidnap his daughters and take away the wealth that this old man has accumulated in his house. If you can do something, try. So I didn't know how to help them. I went to the commander of the platoon and told him that. He said, all right, I'll give you a jeep. I'll give you four soldiers. Go there and bring them. So when we entered that colony, all the gates were locked for it. In those days, during partition, all colonies had gates which could be locked. So we were really, now inside we could get out. And I thought, we have no problem. I have four soldiers, they have plenty of bullets and so on, and they cannot kill anyone like that comes our way. But then immediately the counter thought came, if I do that, these people will kill the 10,000 I have in my camp. So I didn't know what to do. We couldn't reach that address. Soon the police came. So the police came and took me to the police station along with the four soldiers. And they asked those soldiers to lay down their arms. They wouldn't. They begged. They pleaded, please lay down your arms. They looked at me and I said, all right, lay down your arms. So they laid out their arms. They put them in the lockup and started abusing me. Where do you come from? You think by bringing four soldiers, you could go back alive? I said, life and death is in the hands of God, in no one's hands. The chief of the police station, probably he was the chief, he took out a cane and started beating me with it. And said, now you will know who can kill you, God or me. And suddenly a thought came into his mind that these army people have come along with him and let me sound one of my officers. So he rang up one officer, we couldn't get him. Then he rang up the deputy commissioner, rang up and told him there is one man who professes to be chief of the refugee camp in National College, and he has not come with any radari, and he has come into our town, and I have arrested him along with four soldiers whom we have disarmed. So he said, give him the telephone. So he gave me the telephone and he said, Sardar ji, kithe phas gaye ho? ਮੈਂ ਕਿਹਾ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਰਾਜ ਵਿੱਚ ਫਸ ਗਏ ਕਹਿਣ ਲੱਗਾ ਵਾਪਸ ਦਿਓ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਟੈਲੀਫੋਨ ਗਿਵ ਟੂ ਹਿਮ ਐਂਡ ਸੈਡ ਸਮਥਿੰਗ ਲਾਈਕ ਦਿਸ ਕਿ ਵਿਦ ਆਲ ਡਿਗਨਿਟੀ ਐਂਡ ਆਨਰ ਟੇਕ ਹਿਮ ਟੂ ਦੀ ਪਲੇਸ ਵੇਰ ਹੀ ਵਾਂਟਸ ਟੂ ਗੋ ਇਫ ਯੂ ਵਾਂਟਸ ਟੂ ਟੇਕ ਦੋਸ ਪੀਪਲ ਅਵੇ ਅਲੋਂਗ ਵਿਦ ਦੇਅਰ ਬੈਗੇਜ ਲੈਟ ਹਿਮ ਟੇਕ ਦੈਮ ਐਂਡ ਸੋ ਔਨ ਐਂਡ ਲੀਵ ਹਿਮ ਐਟ ਹਿਸ ਕੈਂਪ. The police officer became pale. He took out his turban and put it on my feet. And I said, now you know who can kill God or you. So we came back. That was how I escaped. That's that. I had escaped death already. Now then, I think we have.
Just really quickly, I just want to know where your family was. Like, how were you then reunited with your family after?
Oh, that is a long story.
Okay, later then.